emotions or feelings as being enemy. I think we actually talk about it and get contradictory, not with you, I just mean generally, that it's hard to get the concept that all our feelings are always right all the time. And unless we befriend our emotions and our feelings, really befriend them. There's no such thing as negatives and positives. They're all there for a reason. They're always right all of the time.
Yep.
Unless we get that point, that understanding, at a mind level, we'll always have an aversion to an emotion, and therefore we don't humble ourselves, and we don't want that emotion because it's bad. You know, we push it away, we repress it.
Yeah.
But it is never bad. Now, unless we get that, we never reach
the next step, which is finding out what's driving it.
Yeah.
And that brings up the issue of judgment, which is one of the tools of denial that we use. Whenever we judge the emotion. So, am I saying that anger is bad?
No.
I'm saying anger is a...
out of harmony.
It's a projection, isn't it? It's a denial it's a denial of underlying. But am I saying don't feel your anger?
No.
Because what did I say to you this week? I was feeling angry. So I'm not recommending you don't feel your anger. What I'm saying is feel it and understand there is something underneath it. You need to love all of these emotions. They are all...
Welcome.
Yeah, certainly.
Are you going to make a list of the causal and the more external emotions?
Sure. Okay. Yeah, and I don't know when I'll get to do that. Maybe today or tomorrow. Sure. Let's write down two more of these because these are good. I eat, have sex, meditate, when I feel it happening. So in other words, conversion is when I'm feeling something inside of myself I don't want to feel, I then look for a
distraction
or a substitute in order for me to not feel the emotion itself. We do this all the time, do we not? But how many of you search for food? Chocolate. Chocolate's me. My favourite was ice cream.
Yes.
I used to get a 4-litre container, knife across it, crisscross, dig out 1 litre, then pour over the syrup, and away I go. And I was just addicted to high sugar carbohydrate as a way of getting away from my emotion. Yeah.
How long ago was that?
No, it wasn't last week. About 12 years ago. Now, it's funny. I don't have hardly any desires for food at all. So, what I'm finding is the more and more emotion that I deal with, I very rarely desire food. Now the food I desire is like fruit or, vegetables uncooked. And maybe some nuts occasionally. And that's about it nowadays. That's what I have. But I used to be terrible at it. I used to have whole packets of, all different types of ice creams in particular. And minimising, good old minimising. So what's that? That is, it's happened.
But it wasn't that bad.
I'm okay.
It's no big deal.
Yeah.
That's a big way of tuning out of your emotions, isn't it? Yeah, I was abused as a child, but, doesn't that happen to most people?
Yeah.
Really?
Survived.
I survived. And man, you can actually throw away thousands of emotions you're yet to feel just doing that one thing, can't you?
But we were told to move on.
Exactly, we were.
Yeah.
Sorry?
Now looking in the opposite direction in that you minimise your achievements as well. Is that minimising or are you...
Certainly, yeah. And when you minimise your achievements, you're still minimising an emotion. What is the emotion you don't want to feel? That you're proud or haughty. So there's obviously a judgment of yourself in there that, you know, maybe I'm proud or I'm haughty if I say what I've actually achieved. Yeah, I have a big problem with that still. So. Comes from a feeling of unworthiness. Yeah. Yeah, it's very, very hard sometimes to say good things about yourself when you're feeling, like, inside of yourself when you're feeling bad about yourself. You don't feel like you can say anything good about yourself. Right?
So a child who's absolutely been totally abused who actually has to not feel to be able to survive because if they're very, very young and they need to be taken care of,
yeah.
They have to believe.
Yeah, don't confuse that. All of this stuff is happening because of pain that occurred in your past. Okay? So all of this that happens because of pain that's occurred in the past that you still believe is happening. At the soul level. The truth is it's not happening anymore. Right? It's just in your soul now. Right? And so the key thing to remember with all of this is that, yes, this is why you need to love yourself. Because in the end, everything that you chose to do right now to avoid your emotion, you chose it. Because if you didn't choose it, your life would have been worse probably at some time in the past. Right? And you need to come to love the fact that you were clever enough to establish all of these, you know, fantastic ways of coping with your life. But now you're wanting to become a full-grown man or woman, are you not? Mm-hmm. Don't you want to experience bliss now? Mm-hmm. Well, now we're going to be responsible with these emotions and actually feel them, experience them. Choose that. Don't run away from that. All right. How are we going so far? Now, where does God come in all this? Every time I choose a form of denial, I am also denying myself. So am I loving my own soul? No. Every time I choose to do one of these things, I'm not loving my own soul. And I'm also setting up a state where I can no longer receive love from God. Because I'm denying my emotion. And when you deny your emotion, God's emotion cannot flow to you. Right? So understand that if I love myself, I will choose to deal with my emotions. Right? And when I really love myself will be when I'm dealing with them 24/7. And the only time that's going to happen is when I'm at one with God. And by that stage, all of them are going to be blissful. And up until that time, you'll switch in and out at times. Because you'll get to an emotion that's really hard, you'll get into anger, or you'll get into something else, and you'll go through all of that, then you'll undo all of that, get connected with what's underneath, and then you'll feel that emotion, and then you'll be back feeling some divine love, some more love flowing through to you. And then another emotion will come up, and it'll ebb and flow until you're at one with God. And did many of you watch on the DVD Lucinda, Natalie channeling Lucinda?
Yes.
Yeah. Remember what she said? She said she was in the sixth sphere on the natural love path. She was in her mind. She had to go back to the third sphere and tune into her real emotions. She called it tuning into her real self because she'd learned to tune out of her real self using her intellect. And what she had to do was come back and tune into her real self. Now when she started doing that, she started learning a lot of things about herself that were hard to accept. Right? And she accepted them because she was humble and just felt every one of those emotions pass through her. And that's what you will need to do when you're on the divine path. But you won't do it 100% of the time until you're at one with God.
So what are some other empowering beliefs then that we could use to motivate us, if you like, in the right direction? So the one that if you don't really love yourself, and you won't acknowledge your emotions. I mean, that's an empowering belief. There must be lots of others.
Well, you can come up with some and I'll write them down if you want. What, who of you have, you know, started on the emotional path, and what keeps you going?
My answer is that I have children, and my motivation towards my children is, you know, if I said 110%, that's not the right figure. So I want to, by default, assist my children to have the best possible life. So if I can keep, I got to this last weekend, so yep. If I keep
feeling your own emotions.
Yeah. That if I keep at it,
yep.
No matter how difficult it is,
yep.
Then I really believe that that will somehow flow on to Jeffrey Nichols.
Yep. So your love for others, and if we can just go a little bit deeper with this love for others, remember that your soul is like this great big being pushing out energy into the universe. And the truth is actually that every being and thing in the universe can actually feel your energy. Now, if your energy has a part of the energy you have is like anger, what's every being in the universe feeling? You're adding to the universal anger. Can you see that? If, and so let's say your feeling is like, even just basic things like, say, this will trigger a few of you, eating meat. How many eat meat still? Lots of them. Okay, this will trigger all of it. When you eat meat, what are you saying to every animal?
Thanks very much.
Thank you.
What are you really saying to the animals?
It's unsafe around me.
Yeah, that's what you're really saying to your animals, to all animals. It's unsafe around me because one day you're going to be in my place.
So what's the difference with plants and fruit?
Animals have spirit bodies, and animals are very much a direct reflection of the soul of the person and the collective soul of people on Earth. And so you could say there's levels of life forms that God has created, and animals are obviously the next one down from us as humans. We're the only one with a soul. The animals don't have soul, but they are a complete reflection of our soul. And so, you know, they are, if you like, the next closest thing to us. And for that reason, who wants to live in a world where no animals eat other animals? Mm. Well, in a spirit world, that's what it's like. There's no animals in the spirit world that eat other animals.
Because they don't have bodies.
That's because we create them as to how we want
them
to be in the spirit world.
No, there's a whole lots of animals in the spirit world that have never been created by by a person. They've all been created by God. The animals that have passed from the earth, they do not eat other animals.
They don't eat them.
Well, in the spirit world, nobody eats animals either.
What about fish?
Of course fish is an animal.
But the loaves and fishes.
Well, you can read into the Bible what you want, but okay. I never multiplied any loaves or fishes. I didn't even eat fish, right, in the first century. Yeah. I became a vegetarian in the first century in my teens. I was 12 years old, actually.
Does that include eggs?
Well, it's up to you whether you want to eat eggs or not. And it's up to you whether you want to eat meat or not. I'm not saying any rules whatsoever. Am I saying any rules to you?
No.
All I'm saying is that love for others is a great motivator for you to deal with your own emotions. So what I'm saying is, look at the emotional reason why you think you need to eat meat. Because at the moment, it's not loving animals. That's all. So, let yourself feel about that.
Animals on Earth eat other animals, though. So, what are you saying?
Why do you reckon they eat other animals? Remember what I said. The soul condition of man is impressed upon the animals. So why do you think animals eat other animals on Earth?
Because we eat them.
The crocodiles can't live on grass.
The biggest dinosaurs in history lived on grass. So the truth is they could.
Right?
Crocodiles in the spirit world don't live on eating other animals. And they don't need to hear. The thing is, we need to understand here, and this is something that all of us need to understand at a deeper level. Your soul creates everything around you. Your soul, your feelings, your emotions, your passions, your desires create everything around you, including what happens between animals, because of your soul. Right? It's a complete reflection of our collective, what they call consciousness, which I would prefer to call soul condition.
Existence.
Mm-hmm.
So that's causing them to be extinct?
Yes, yes, definitely. And even in a physical level, but when you think about it, people go out and shoot them for whatever they want from them. You know, some aphrodisiac or something that they're trying to get from them, or their pelt or whatever. But even from an emotional perspective, that is true as well. I don't know if you've ever experimented with this, but I'm sure if you do experiment with this with birds or something like that around your home, you will notice huge changes in terms of the attractions that occur, in terms of, you know, what birds come to you rather than to your next door neighbour or whatever. So, you know, all you need to do is experiment with this to prove it's truth or not. But the truth is, your soul affects every single thing around you. So isn't that a good reason for you to work on your soul? Right? So I'm not just talking your children, I'm talking your husband or wife, your children, your dog, your cat, your house, your plants in the house, your plants outside of your house are all affected by your soul condition. When I started dealing with my negative emotions, I didn't do anything different with the two plants I had in my house, and all of a sudden they grew 3 feet in the space of about 3 months. Why did that happen? I didn't do anything different. I watered them once every 2 weeks, like I always do. Didn't do anything else. Why? Because the soul condition change they can feel. And they respond to it. That's what they respond to. Your feelings. Yeah? Right?
Hey, Jay. In the time of the dinosaurs, when there weren't people on Earth, what was affecting the soul condition, or what soul condition was affecting Tyrannosaurus Rex?
Everything was neutral then. And there's an assumption that Tyrannosaurus Rex ate meat. And that's not true. Right? Back then, when men weren't here.
Yeah, very big teeth then.
Yeah, but big teeth don't mean I gotta eat meat
big
with them.
Plants too.
There's a lot of animals in there. There's a lot of animals that have big teeth and eat plants.
Yes. Just with the study of body blood types and body types, you know, there's less that certain body types like mine needs to eat meat to, you know, nourish you properly.
We can come up with hundreds of intellectual arguments about what our body needs. Experiment with your soul. Deal with the emotions inside of yourself and then see whether you feel like eating meat.
Yeah, when I was vegetarian, I used to get sick a lot.
So why did you get sick a lot? When you get sick a lot, there's an emotion causing the sickness. So what emotion was it? See, we often say, all right, no, I need the food. That's what causes my sickness. Now I'm having this food. I don't have the sickness. But the emotion behind you needing that food. Do you follow me?
Mm-hmm.
And it's that emotion that hasn't been addressed yet. So if you went off meat right now, you'd get sick again.
Yeah.
I'm saying you would.
Would I?
Yeah. Mm-hmm. And the reason why you would is because the emotion driving the need for that.
Maybe around worthiness, I certainly got that one.
Like, I used to eat meat 5 times a day. So, yeah, I did. I was one of these bodybuilders trying to put on weight, right? Yeah. And honestly, it was just all emotionally driven.
So would there be a collective grief on Earth for people?
Yes.
Because they're not connected, many aren't connected to God?
Yeah.
And so that's a collective, that's one of the collective things.
Yeah.
So
the whole of humankind on the earth, and even in the spirit world too, there's areas like this too, where the whole of the people in one region give off an aura, which then it affects every living thing around it. Right? So collectively, all of us are affecting every living thing around us. Right? And we're doing that every single moment. Because it's not our intellect that drives it, it's our soul, our emotions. And what's ever in there is what drives it.
So committing to the divine love path and committing to feeling emotion is the most profound way to serve humanity.
Yes. It is the most profound way to influence everything around you. Yeah, let me show you some experiments that people overseas have tried, right? There's this couple who are really good friends of mine who live in London. And they have a three-year-old son, his name's Luca. And their names are Mike and Fee. And every single emotion they deny in themselves, Luca experiences.
Wow.
Right? So, and he would reflect that emotion back to them every single moment. So one night, in the middle of the night, Luca falls out of bed and hits his eye on the corner of the bed. And he's got this great big black eye and he wakes up screaming. That exact moment, Fee, his mother, was having a dream. And she was afraid and fearful right at that same moment of something happening to her. There was another time when she was upstairs crying about some, in fact trying to shove down some emotions about being hurt physically. And he, at the same moment, he was out on a pontoon out in the sea with Mike, and he had an injury that affected him in exactly the same way that she felt. And they were like 400 yards away from each other, not knowing what was going on. Mike would have a feeling within himself of I'm unworthy, or I'm feeling bad about myself, or I'm feeling stupid. And Luca would come up to him and say, silly Mike, silly Mike, silly Mike. And Mike would go, what am I denying now? How many other things? Andrew was there. There's so many.
And then when he dealt with the unworthiness or the silliness, he was so proud of himself. Luca said, came down like for breakfast one morning, he says, smart Mike. And Mike went,
yeah. I've done it. Yeah.
So this is happening to all parents and children, but they're not aware of it.
They're just not aware of it.
Yeah.
Every single one of you have young children in particular. They are a complete mirror of what's going on inside of you that you are trying to avoid at that instant. So if they're crying in that instant about something, it is your emotional denial generally that they're crying for.
So, Joe, when does that stop?
Well, the way I'd like to look at it is when it stops is when you feel your emotions. But that's not the one you wanted to hear, was it?
I don't have
It obviously stops when you have when you own all of your emotions. They stop. Now, I'll give you an example of that. Mike was walking down with Luca down the beach, and then all of a sudden, Mike started feeling like he needed to cry, and Luca started playing up, like he started getting really restless and yelling at Mike and all that kind of stuff. Mike sat down on the beach and just cried. And what happened is Luca just stopped what he was doing. He stopped being a nuisance. And he sat down next to Mike and just folded his arms like that and looked at the ground. And he sat there like that for nearly 30 minutes while Mike cried. And he didn't do anything naughty in that time. Right? Then when Mike stopped crying, Luca said, we're not on play now. So he knew straight away. There was another lady who we stayed with in London as well. She has an 8-year-old daughter. And what was happening, we were having this conversation about this lady's life, and she was describing an event where she went up to her father, who lived in the north of England, who was laying on his deathbed, and he died, in fact, a week later. And she began describing this event where she went up to see her father laying on his deathbed. And all of a sudden, her daughter just burst out crying and ran into her arms and just hugged her and sobbed. And Carolyn looked at me and said, what's going on? Like, right? And I said to Carolyn, well, what were we just talking about? And she said, oh, my dad. And I said, and what do you not want to feel about your dad? And then Carolyn connected instantly to that. And she started crying. Carolyn started crying. And the instant Carolyn started crying, her daughter, Laura, her name is, got off her lap, stopped crying instantly, and sat down and ate like nothing had happened. Yeah. So children are a complete reflection of our emotional denial. So if you love your children, it's a good reason to deal with your emotions. It's when you shut... A lot of us feel, oh, I can't be emotional in front of my children. How many of us feel that? Lots of us feel that generally. Right? The truth is, if you do not allow your emotions 100% of the time, whether you're in front of your children or not, what is going to happen is your children will be affected by those emotions you deny in yourself. They enter your child because you're not feeling them yourself. See, what happens is, if you can just picture your body, right? You've got this emotion. Emotion, remember, is energy in motion, right? When this energy in motion flows through you, it's not going anywhere else. It's just flowing through you. But what happens when you stop it and block it? It hits the place where you're blocking it, and then it just shoots out everywhere, right? And who's that going to enter? Anything around you. And this is a good reason to love your emotions. Very powerful. So love for others is a good reason. Any others? Love for others, good reason for dealing with my emotions.
Having a goal and vision and achieving
it. So what's our goal or vision? A bit shiny, is it? Or?
Yes.
A bit of? At one moment with God. Obviously, God does not have any emotions that are sad, angry, upset, or you could say God does not have any emotions that are disharmonious with bliss. So if I'm at one with God, what does that mean? I'm also going to be in a state of bliss. Yeah? So it's a good reason to deal with your emotions, isn't it? Yeah?
The reason for me is the excruciating agony of avoiding pain.
Yeah. Real pain... I'll change this one again. Real pain is... the pain of avoidance in the end. Right? All pain that you experience in the end is the pain of avoidance. The way to avoid real pain is to feel everything, including any pain. Because that pain, the pain that we feel is not the pain of avoidance. Who feels that their life's a bit messy? Well, it's messy because we've avoided our pains in the past. And what we've done in the way the Hara likens it to a puddle or a lake, if you like, that we drop a pebble into, and you get these ripple effects coming out all the time, right? So the question you've got to ask yourself is, do I want to keep dropping in the same type of thing? Because at the moment, if my life's in a state of pain, I'm going and I'm feeling my emotions, at least I'm fixing it up. But if I'm not feeling my emotions and I'm dropping in more avoidance, then it's going to get worse. It's going to keep getting worse. Yeah.
Another motivation would be, because with doing that, you get to know your own truth, your own self, your truth, because then you would understand. You would have acknowledged, you would become aware, you
Yeah, you get to know, you get to be real. And most of us are not real.
What was the question?
These are things to focus on if we feel in our terrible emotional state and we feel like giving up. What we'll become is we will become real. Right? Being real is really important to God. What the ego is really a false projection, isn't it, of ourselves that we've come to believe. Yeah.
All our illnesses, is that because we've stuffed down our emotions too long?
Totally. It's a good motivator. Every single physical pain in your body, every illness you ever have is a result of emotional denial.
What about the area of prosperity?
Yeah, well, if you...
I suppose what would be prosperous in one moment may not be prosperous when you actually exist.
Exactly. So what are we saying when we're talking about prosperity, really?
Abundance.
And obviously, how do you spell it? So, yes, my spelling is never good.
That's pretty cool.
So we have abundance. But what we define as abundance now and what we define as abundance then will obviously be very different.
About being sick, is you, because you're not dealing with your own, you're attracting the stuff that's going to make you sick. Is that it? Is that it? Or is it an internal problem?
There's a lot of things that work with sickness. The majority of sicknesses, what happens is that there's an emotion for a start in our soul. The emotion in our soul blocks our energy flow in our spirit body. And the energy flow in our spirit body is what keeps our physical body well. So when the energy stops flowing in a certain part of our spirit body, our physical body then becomes affected by that stop, by that slowing energy, or that energy that's now stopped flowing. And that then exposes that part of the body to outside risks, or internal risks, like, you know, cancer is an internal risk, right? But it exposes that part of the body to that risk. And so all sickness is emotional. Everyone.
Colds, flus,
yeah. This week I've had a runny nose like 5 days out of the 7, like constantly. I think I used a whole box of tissues on the way here actually. And the reason why was because, like, I'm cycling between wanting to deal with this grief. I deal with it for 2 or 3 hours and then I tune out of it. And when I tune out of it, my nose starts running again, right? And then... Do you see what's happening? Every time I tune out of the grief, instead of just feeling the grief, my nose starts running. And when I tune back into my grief, my nose stops running. And it's been like that the entire week. Somebody else would have said, I've got allergies.
Isn't it just a cleansing
of your
emotions?
A
more of a reason you can
Oh, certainly your body can go through cycles where you're cleansing your emotions. Like, there was one cycle that I had where... for 2 weeks I had really bad smelly feet, right?
Yeah.
And yes, it was an emotional relief to that, and it, once I release that emotion, the physical body changes. I'm talking...
Was that a soul condition?
Sorry. Who wants to know whether their husband's got that emotion? I can't even remember what it is now. But just for 2 weeks I was just... Yeah, my feet have never stunk all my life. And then all of a sudden for 2 weeks they did and then it went away.
I can't understand it when it's a highly contagious illness. But,
your body has absolutely everything inside of itself when it's working perfectly to get rid of any illnesses whatsoever. Your body right now is full of so many bugs that could kill you. And yet they don't. Because your body is perfectly, when it's perfectly running, it has the ability to cope with anything. It's only when you're out of harmony emotionally that your body no longer has any way to cope with those particular things and they take over.
It's running
it's run down. But then there's a lot of diseases today that are called diseases that are almost purely emotional based, right? Mm-hmm. Things like heart disease and cancers and leukemia and like all of these different things. Very, all emotionally caused. The best thing to do is this. Assume that everything is emotionally caused, because it is. Now, I know that a lot of you have been looking into nutrition for years, right?
Yeah.
And looking into like eating the right foods, doing the right thing, doing that. The truth is that while all of those can have a positive effect on you, they're having a positive effect on you, firstly, because there's emotions involved in your desire to do that. And secondly, because you're now taking a lot more care of yourself than you were before, and there's a lot of other emotional reasons too. The truth is that when you are connected with yourself emotionally, you will want to look after yourself. So you don't have to throw all that away, but understand that every illness inside of you is emotionally caused. And I can feel lots of disbelief about this subject.
Yeah, well, bodily fluids and that sort of thing that have passed on, HIV or whatever, people who don't deserve it, but they
have
no idea they've come into contact, but they have.
My comment remains the same.
Is it the same with children who have leukemia and die, and that it's emotionally based from childhood?
Oftentimes it's emotionally based through spirit attraction as well.
What about from parents?
From parents, yeah. Obviously a child cannot have a spirit attached to it if the parent has a protective, does not have that emotion. Right? So a lot of things like leukemia, childhood cancers are very much caused by spirit attraction generally, but that's caused by the emotions of the parents that they've not yet dealt with.
Right? So illness is another great opportunity to actually look at what you might need to be looking at.
Exactly.
Yeah.
So, like, I feel a bit tight here in the throat, right? Right? And I know exactly why. Right? I feel a bit tight. This week I felt really tight across the chest. I've not had asthma for nearly 14 years. And this week, one night, I had asthma. So what's that? Across here was grief. This was grief, and this was about saying the truth. Right? So there's some things I need to work on, in particular with my soulmate.
You just asked me a question.
Sorry.
How does the body deal with man-made substances that impact on our being as such? Because there's a lot of stuff out there too.
You will find that you will not even be able to cope with ingesting a man-made substance.
There's actually airborne substances which have been sprayed out onto the populace.
Yep. And certainly, when you're in a certain soul condition, you'll feel those particular things, and you'll notice there's something wrong there, and you'll want to move from there. You will. So, like, I can smell now when a certain preservatives have been put into, like, certain foods. And I pick it up to eat it, and I can't eat it because it doesn't smell right. But I could never do that before. One lady tested me in the USA. In the USA, they have Vegemite with a lot more different preservatives than they do in Australia. And she bought... I got my Vegemite from Australia before I went. She got Vegemite over there. And I said, look, these two are different. I can't eat yours. And she said, nah, I don't believe you. I said, yeah, they're different. I can smell the difference. And so she got me to close my eyes, and she made me smell and tell which one was the one that was the one that I couldn't.
The real deal.
Yeah. Yeah. You'll be able to do that automatically. Your soul will know. This is where kinesiology. That's what it's all about, isn't it?
Yeah.
Your soul knows, right? That's what kinesiology is all about. That's why it works. Your soul knows. So use all of those things, that's fine. But in the end, it's not going to get you closer to God. But they're all good reasons to keep doing it. Because there are going to be times in your progression where you just want to give up. Yeah, totally. You just want to give up. And you'll want to give it all away, and you'll think AJ's some kind of idiot that's brought me into this terrible place. Trust me, you will. Guaranteed. Almost everybody I know has said that to me at some point.
At work, I'm just feeling challenged with experiencing my emotions at work and how much, do I let myself cry when I'm massaging somebody?
Because of the type of work you do, it's probably easier than other types of work. I would let myself cry if I was massaging somebody and all of a sudden I felt an emotion that was resonant with their emotion or whatever, and I'd just let myself cry. Now, you'll probably have to explain to your clients before you that you really believe in emotions, and just be open with everyone. I really believe in emotions. What did you say, Tris, when you started work?
I said that I'm dealing with trying to deal with all my emotions, and anything that will upset me will be my own emotion, so they really can't do anything to me.
Yeah, and Tristan explained to them that he wanted to feel his emotions even when he was at work. He got the job. And it doesn't mean they're going to let him do it either.
There is such a word as ethics. Ethical behaviour?
Yep, what's the ethical behaviour?
With your emotions, if you have emotions that really are not appropriate.
But remember what I said. Here's me. Here's the emotion flowing through me. As soon as I stop the emotion flowing through me, what's going to happen? It's going to go out. What's more ethical?
Well, deal with it later.
No, that's not ethical. That's throwing it out right at that moment. It's not ethical. You'll need to change your definitions of ethical if you want to deal with your emotions. I'm just being blunt, but it's true. We need to come to see everything how God sees it. Do you understand that? How does God see your emotions? As precious. It is you. It's your soul. He views your emotions as precious. When you're at one with God, what will you view your emotions as? Precious. They are precious. You want to feel them right now. You won't want to put them off, right? And you can take on man's definition of ethics or man's definition of love or man's definition. But if you take on that, what are you going to get? What we've got right now. Do you want that still?
No.
Well, then you'll need to change and do it God's way if you want. Now, you don't have to. I'm not saying you have to. You can keep doing it self-reliant way if you want. Remember, I said there's a difference between self-reliance. You can keep doing that if you want. It's your choice. I'm not saying you don't have to do that. I'm saying you can. You're allowed to. You've got free will.
AJ, how do spirits do it in the spirit world? Like, say someone passes, like you were telling me about my dad, who's not in a very good place at the moment when he passed.
Yeah.
Does he get helped by others, or does he have to come to it himself, or how does he do it?
He will only be helped if he wants help.
Right. So the first step is to ask, is it? Yep. Or to have a desire.
It always gets down to desire.
Desire to progress? Is that what does he desire?
He needs to have a pure desire to deal with his own crap, shall we say.
Okay.
Yeah. It is a very good book, I think I mentioned last week, Postmortem Journal. Postmortem Journal. If you can get a copy of it, it's a very rare book and it's not published anymore. And if you can get a copy of it, get a copy of it. If anyone wants to type up a copy of it, I've got a copy, and we can give it to everyone.
How many pages?
I don't know. I think it's a couple hundred, or a hundred or so. Right? Written by Jane Sherwood. It's a copy. It's a description of Lawrence of Arabia's passing. And in it, he deals only with emotions. And it's a really, really good book because it focuses on the importance of dealing with emotions even when you're in the spirit world, and also focuses on what happens energetically when a person refuses to deal with their emotions. What was his name? T. Lawrence, was it? Lawrence of Arabia. Whenever he decided to not deal with his emotions, he projected these emotions at his teacher, and the teacher instantly left. And he didn't come back again until he owned his emotions.
Can I type that up?
Sure, I'll bring it next time when we come down. Yeah.
That'd be great.
There is a website you can go to that deals in out-of-print books.
Yeah, that's where I got this book from. But it's like, I don't think I'd have 100 of them.
No.
It's a fantastic book. Because it outlines, even in the spirit world, what's happening with regard to emotional processing. Yeah. And the explanations that he received about his emotions.
We could do it as a Word document and then email to everybody.
Thank you.
It's an awesome book. It's really worth reading. Whenever you do that, whenever you block your emotion, you are instantly projecting it. You are instantly at that moment damaging everything around you. If you want to choose that, you can. You're allowed to, because you've got free will. But do you want to keep choosing that?
Really? So everybody's got free will, so many more people could be in prison if they executed what you're telling them to.
Why would they be in prison?
That could be illegal.
How can feeling your causal emotion be illegal?
Wicked thoughts, wicked emotions.
Yeah, I'm not saying to act upon them. I'm saying to feel them. Did I ever say to act upon them?
No.
In fact, I've said quite the opposite, haven't I? Don't act upon them. I don't want you all to become murderers just because you're angry with someone. Right? So it's when you act upon them that you cause damage to others, right? But it's not only when you act upon them, and this is what I'm saying. It's when you refuse to feel them from that moment you are causing damage to others, whether you think you are or not.
But aren't those so-called negative emotions like murder and all those sort of things, isn't there still something underneath that?
Yes, totally.
Yeah.
Totally.
So, yeah. If you're actually feeling your causal, you wouldn't end up in jail.
Exactly.
You know, I want to murder that person, but I'm really feeling it.
Exactly.
Right.
Yeah. Exactly.
So acknowledging and then accepting that feeling is not enough. Do you need to experience it?
People say, I acknowledge the feeling. Then second thing is, I accept the feeling. And then they say, that's enough, don't need to go to the third, which is to experience the feeling. The truth is that it's only this that will release it.
So explain more about experiencing.
What if we have a break? And we can go to loo and do whatever we want. Have a bit of a... And when we come back, we'll talk more about this. It's great to talk to each other, isn't it?
Yes. Yes.
Thank you.
So, experiencing your emotions. Yeah. What we often do, you know, is we do the first two. We acknowledge that we have them, and we feel those kind of things, but we don't do the experience side. And it's the experience side that clears your soul. And John Bradshaw wrote one thing that I'd have to agree with, and that is that grief is the biggest emotion, and grief is the healing emotion. So in other words, you're going to need to do quite a lot of crying. Now, the thing to remember about experiencing emotion is this. Your soul is automatically built to experience emotion. So, if you're not experiencing emotion, it's not because you're not capable of experiencing it, because God created you to be capable of experiencing it. The issue is that you have created blocks to experiencing your emotion. So, rather than let's talking about how to feel, the truth is, you already know how to feel. You already know how to feel every emotion. At the soul level, that's the way you were created. When you were born, do you think that you turned off any emotion? No. You were a baby, you had no mental conception of any emotion, did you? And yet you felt every one of them, didn't you? So what the what's the problem become? The problem has become how I block my emotions. So really what we need to address in order to experience our emotion is all of our fears about why we don't want to experience our emotion. That's what we need to address. When you address all of those fears, as each fear falls away, a new emotion will pop its head up and you'll be able to feel it. So what are some of your fears about dealing with emotion?
Change.
People won't like me.
I'll die.
That it won't stop.
That there's something wrong with me.
Embarrassment.
Well, you got lots. You're writing all these out because these are really good. These are really good. Embarrassment.
Everyone will know and see.
Shame.
Shame.
Fear of shame.
Feeling weak.
Vulnerable.
Like
it'll be too painful.
I'll lose control.
Yeah. Obviously.
Unworthy.
All right, can you start seeing what's going on? The reason why we can't feel these emotions is because we've got all of these beliefs. And we think all of these beliefs are true. And maybe at one point in our life they were true. That's all the more reason for us to believe they're true. But the truth is none of those things are true from God's perspective. From God's perspective, all of these things are just fears about our feeling an underlying thing. So what are we afraid of here, really?
Rejection.
We're afraid of feeling the emotion of nobody wanting us, aren't we? If we believe people won't like me if I feel my emotion, then I'm actually afraid of feeling an underlying emotion. Can you see that? And the underlying emotion is, people don't like me, I'm actually afraid that nobody will like me at all. There's a feel. So what do I feel right now? I feel like nobody likes me. And I'm not letting myself feel it. Like, it's there within me, but I'm not letting myself feel it. So if I feel that, if I'm afraid of that, I need to feel that nobody likes me. I need to put myself in a place where I'm willing to feel that. If I'm afraid of that, where do I need to put myself? Into failure. Be a failure. And feel that. Feel it like you're a failure. Everything that you're afraid of. How do I do that?
Postpone that one.
Sorry, Grant?
Don't be afraid of dying. Rather than be frightened, and just let it go and say, okay, I'm going to die or die.
Yeah. Let yourself feel like you're going to die.
That doesn't sound very frightening. It's, oh, well, I'm going to die, I'm going to die. So you're not really feeling, you're not really facing emotion.
If you let yourself feel that you are dying, mm-hmm. right, and put yourself in a position, and usually when we have that emotion, there's usually something that happened in our childhood that caused us to feel like we'll die if we deal with an emotion. So usually there's been some abuse or there'd been some very traumatic event like a car crash or, you know, lots of different events like that that cause us to be so afraid after that point. Yeah. I had this one a lot. It gets projected at me all the time. What about this one? It's going to be never ending. A lot of these fears, remember what fears are? They are
false evidence appearing real.
So they're false expectations appearing real, right? Or we could say they're false emotions appearing real, or expectations, right? Like, how can I go insane if I'm feeling my own causal emotions? Isn't it the truth, really, that the time I'm going to be insane is when I'm not feeling my causal emotions? And how can it be never-ending? Isn't it the truth, really, that I'm obviously a finite being? Only God's infinite. Right? So therefore, my emotion must be finite. Doesn't that make sense? Embarrassment. What's that about? Making a fool of yourself. So I believe I'm a fool. Right? In my heart, I believe I'm a fool, and I'm trying to constantly prove to myself otherwise.
So if you block these things, how do you feel if I'm physically putting myself in the situation you feel it?
Well, that's what the law of attraction is there for, to put you in the situation you feel it. The truth is that every single day, if you have this feeling within you of failure, you'll be finding already in your life you'll be attracting failure. The truth is that the law of attraction is already putting into your life absolutely everything to trigger this emotion right now. So this is why it's so important to look at the law of attraction, because the law of attraction is there to tell you what you're not dealing with right now, right today, right this moment. And don't forget, your law of attraction is good at, you know, it has, if we can use the term good and bad connotations, if we can use those terminologies, the law of attraction will bring you everything. You are here today, and that's obviously something that's positive about your law of attraction from your perspective. You're wanting to learn about truth, so that something caused you to be here, listening to this insane man.
AJ, with the law of attraction, are there a hierarchy of neuroses? So your biggest ones come up first, and then later on, when you've got rid of those, then you get a bit more failure or a bit more something else. Is that how it works? Or do you get the works all the time?
Like, I'm close to it now.
The law of attraction operates upon your collective soul condition right at this moment. It's just the areas which you become aware of that you probably deal with firstly. So the truth is, right at this moment, you might have 100 different emotions you have yet to resolve. Right? And if you do, the law of attraction will be bringing to you lots of different events in your day-to-day life to trigger every one of those 100 emotions.
Really?
Yeah. Now, often we don't allow ourselves to consider it until we exercise our will to see different ones. And so that's why we deal with one, and then we deal with the next, and then we deal with the next. Right? But the truth is, the law of attraction is actually operating upon your complete soul condition, not just on the emotion you're dealing with right now.
That would depend, though, on how much you interact with life. I mean, if you sit in the cave and meditate in a puddle of peacefulness, you're not going to talk to anyone, you're not going to meet anybody, the phone's not going to ring. So
that's why
going to happen.
That's why I don't recommend isolation.
Someone might jackhammer your roof, though.
The village dog runs in front of you and gets kicked.
No, honestly, if we all went to a monastery for a year, do you think there'd be as many emotions triggered as if you lived down here in Sunshine Coast for a year?
No.
So where's the best place for your soul?
In life.
Sunshine Coast, obviously. That's why you're here. You think it's the best place, obviously. Your soul does. You attracted it, right? So this is the best place for you to be, right? A lot of people go off to a monastery or off to meditation or off to these different things, off to India to find myself or whatever. And the truth is, in a lot of those cases, we do find a portion of ourselves because we have the right attitude at that time to find a portion of ourselves. Right? But the truth is, you can find everything about yourself right here. And in fact, right here is far better, because you'll get triggered a lot more here than you're going to be in some monastery in the middle of India. Isn't that right?
Yes.
Yeah. How many of you want to run away from your life?
Yeah. Run away.
No. Let's say get rid of a good half of it. What it's attracting. But you see, it's just like everything that your life is attracting is perfectly aligned to deal with your current emotions. God's laws are perfect. This is the thing to understand about God. God's laws are perfect. The law of attraction is perfect in its operation. All right? So everything that's in your current life right now, you attract it. And it's there to help you expose and experience an emotion. Everything is there to help you expose and experience an emotion. Now, what will you do with it? Are you going to experience the emotion, or you're just going to dismiss that one and go on to the next one? And all of you know what happens in your life when you do that, don't you? Mm-hmm. What happens?
The
next day or the next 3 days, it's back again, isn't it? And it's back again, it's back again, it's back again. And after a year of that, yeah, and everything starts degrading in your body and you get more sick and unwell because we avoid these laws of attraction that are occurring in our lives. So, understand that the reason for all fears is because we have these emotions within us that cover over this whole list of things we don't want to feel. And it's your choice to not feel that creates all of your inner turmoil. And mine too.
I just wanted to sort of share that, I don't know whether people realise or not, but once you've dealt with the issue, which I haven't dealt with any, I don't think, in completion, but like you said, you never ever have to deal with that again.
Mm.
Ever, ever. So ever. Whatever pain you're in, once you get to the bottom of it, you never ever have to feel that particular pain again.
Yeah.
Mm. That was really like an aha moment for me. I went, oh, good, let's get into it.
Because if you avoid an emotion now, you're just putting it off for later. And in fact, if you avoid an emotion now, what are you doing? You're projecting it. As soon as you project it, you're causing more damage around yourself. There's a law of compensation, karma it's called, right? Back on yourself for that as well. So what are you actually doing every time you avoid an emotion? You're making it worse for yourself for later.
Yeah.
That's really what you're doing. Yeah. And the key is, do you want to do that? Well, obviously a lot of us do, right? I know I am. So...
Is there, when you're talking about those different thoughts, then under each of those is a different emotion, is there a level of emotions of like to experience under, like a layers of emotions that you go through to get to the bottom? Because I imagine if you're denying something, getting to the point of going, wow, the truth that this really happened to me,
mm-hmm.
and then therefore grief for yourself, or mm-hmm. for the love of yourself.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, it is true that, you know, it's like layers of an onion. Right, really, it's just like emotion after emotion, and there are some very core ones. But the question I'd have to ask is, why do you want to know what the core one is when you're not yet really to feel that one? See, a lot of times what we do with our mind is we're constantly trying to look for the answer at the end, when the answer that's right there facing us right at this moment, we're ignoring. How do you get to the inside of an onion? You peel off each.
Just cut it.
Never, lady. I didn't think of that.
I'm very anxious for you to tell us how to discover what those layers are. I mean, even if it's only the outside one, how do I find out what that is?
I've already told you how.
Check out more of
attraction. Okay, so I'm attracted to all you folks to come and mix with today. What does that taught me? I mean, what's my
well, it's obviously a lovely emotion. You want to find out some more truth and you want to see how it affects your life. That's really good. What's wrong with that? Yeah. But what happened yesterday?
I can't think of anything else that happened or didn't have any bouncing. I don't think I saw anybody yesterday. One thing that there might have been an adversary. And tell me that could really work as badly as this. I'm waiting for a passport to be produced in Canberra, mm-hmm. and it's taken weeks and weeks and weeks. At last, a letter came after about six weeks or more then, mm-hmm. and it was an inquiry from them. They needed a different photo. And the chap who, from the British Embassy in Canberra, might have been, it was a handwritten envelope, and the script was so poor that it went on a detour to S before it came back to my place, so another week was lost.
Yeah.
And so, anyway, I dealt with that immediately and didn't waste a day. And then
I stop you now, though? What was the feeling you had?
Well, annoyance, I suppose.
Right, what's annoyance?
I recognise that I've been judgmental, thinking that they should have been capable of better.
Well, no, that is.
Anyway, I returned to their letter and waited weeks and weeks and more, and it came yesterday. And you know, it came back with my name misspelled.
You're attracting this, yes.
Did I make that silly fellow in the office?
Yes.
Yes.
Everything that happens to you is created by you.
I spelled it properly.
What's the real you? What's the real you?
Should I know?
It's your soul.
Which made him annoyed with you, so he's got your name to delay you.
Yeah, yes, that went through my head. Surely he's done this just to, you know. Get
yes.
Back at me.
Yeah.
Would you?
Yeah.
I wouldn't do that to him.
Wouldn't you?
Anyway, I told him. He was
forgiven. But in your heart, you haven't forgiven him. The truth is that you were annoyed.
Yeah.
It's your soul's emotion. It's not your handwriting that created this. It's not what you wrote that created this. It's your soul's emotion. There's a feeling of annoyance. Annoyance is an anger-based feeling, is it not?
Yeah.
So what's under annoyance? What do you feel underneath annoyance? Frustrated is another anger-based emotion. That's a denial of the underlying emotion. What's under the frustration?
So how can I deal with that?
Well, this is what I'm trying to help you do right now.
I'll let you have it.
No, I've got enough of my own. I'm not doing enough. What I'm saying to you is the law of attraction brought this event into your life. Right? And you just skipped over it, like you're doing right now, in fact. You are skipping over it and ignoring it. You are not allowing yourself to go into the deeper emotion.
Mm-hmm.
The deeper emotion that created it.
I can feel
it. Right? And you want to skip over it. You do not want to know what the deeper emotion is at the moment.
And will it be an emotion just related to that subject matter? Or will it be a general emotion that an unfortunate way I have from dealing with all my...
So what are you trying to do now?
Divert.
No, you're not. No, you're trying to intellectualise your emotion. Can you see what you're doing? You're intellectualising your emotion right now. You're trying to find out an intellectual reason for what's going on. You felt annoyed. Go back to that feeling of annoyance. Now follow that path. Down into annoyance, down into frustration, down into anger. And what's underneath that? Follow that path. Emotionally follow that path down. At the moment, you're skipping over that with your mind. There's an emotion in your soul that created all of those events. So what's the emotion? Does anyone want to have a guess at what the emotion
is? Is it fear? Good enough?
Well, fear is a capping emotion too, isn't it?
Unworthiness.
Well, that's pretty general, unworthiness, isn't it? That's pretty big.
What about loss of control?
Right, wanting to have control, so being out of control, fear of being out of control. What else?
Abandoned.
What things upset you?
Yeah.
You are upset about your name being misspelled. See, now you're intellectualising.
Rather than the technicalities of how.
So why are you annoyed at the delay?
Because I've got a deadline to keep, and I'm like, this is coming up here.
So how does that make you feel?
I suppose I'm annoyed that I committed to a holiday thingy.
Yeah.
It has to be done by a certain date. And it's going to expire very soon.
Okay.
I can't go.
So what's going to happen if you don't get your passport?
I'll probably lose about $1,500 worth of holiday.
How does that feel?
Rotten.
Go deeper, what's wrong? More. How does it feel?
Wasteful.
So, wasteful is not really an emotion, is it?
No.
There's a feeling. See, this is where it's quite difficult at the start, isn't it? Can you see that? Like, because a lot of times what we're feeling is this top level capping thing, like annoyed, and then we try to dismiss it. I try harder. So what do I normally do? Try harder. So that's what you've done. Tried harder to get everything on time, get everything sorted out. You know, try. But it's your soul doing the opposite. Your soul's doing the opposite of that. Your soul's saying, no, hang a sec. I need to trigger this emotion that's going on inside of me that you're totally oblivious to at the moment. That's what your soul's saying, right? So the key is to get below that annoyance and into the deeper stuff.
And then the passport would arrive quickly?
The passport will probably arrive the next day.
Yeah.
After you've dealt with the emotion.
Of the emotion.
After you've let go of the emotion. Yeah. I've had things happen within a day when I've dealt with the emotion. And then I've had other things wait 6 months while I haven't dealt with the emotion. Right, when they could have happened in a day.
Okay. But that situation, it didn't start out that she was necessarily annoyed about it. It was set the whole thing in motion, sent off for the passport, information, etc. Knowing that she's got the deadline.
But the soul has an emotion, and it's been there for ages. It's been there from her childhood. And there's going to be has there been lots of events in your life where people have let you down and got late and delayed and all those kind of things?
So that circumstance doesn't really matter. It's what feeling you get.
What's the feeling? Is there been lots of events in your life that have caused you to feel annoyed?
So are you annoyed with yourself?
Yeah,
when you let down
other people because you're like... My father always expected everyone to be perfect, and I think that I was a bit like that, especially if they're British.
Now, isn't it so funny, isn't it? Now, when you just let yourself go to there, it's just like that, isn't it? Can you see that? Can you see what it's all about? You now expect perfection.
I'm angry because I do expect
it. But your father expected perfection of you. And how did that feel?
Well, I haven't really been critical of it. I think it's done as...
Now you're intellectualising it.
Yeah. It didn't do us any harm, though.
Yes. Now you... It happened, but it's no big deal. Can you see what... Now, it's lovely you brought up this example, because can you see what we do? Can you see what we do? And all of us have been guilty of doing this, right? It's not something that's... Yeah. We just go, we just say, yes, the law of attraction brought me this thing, but it's nothing to do with me, unless it's good, of course. If it's good, it had to have something to do with me, right? If it's like uncomfortable to me, then it can't have had anything to do with me. And the truth is it's got everything to do with you. Everything to do with you. And you need to at least start admitting that to yourself even. Right? God's laws are perfect. They expose everything. But you can see what we do is we feel the top level emotion, in this case annoyance, which is just an anger-based emotion, which is just separating us from the underlying causal emotion. And yet, in your discussion, you were talking, and then all of a sudden you start talking about your dad and perfection. And there's the key to everything, but you don't want to feel it. And the next words were, like, yeah, but it's no big deal, right? It's a huge deal. Like, being expected as a little child to do everything perfectly from day one, that's a huge deal. Like, that is a terrible burden that you place on your children, right? Your father placed a terrible burden on you. Now, I'm not condemning or judging your father, right? He has his own emotional reasons why he did that, and he needs to experience those, live or past. He needs to experience those. The truth is that it's a terrible burden to place that on you as a child, and you are not letting yourself experience that, because you want to believe your father was good. So you won't allow yourself to believe or to feel the emotion of how terrible you felt having to be perfect all the time. So go there. Forget about, and this is one thing I like about the John Bradshaw book, because it says in there, your parents' emotions or reasons are superfluous.
Are what?
Superfluous. It is of no consequence in your discussion of your own emotion. Because if you justify your parents, what are you doing? You're justifying the reason for your emotion. In the end, what are you doing? Tuning out of your own emotion. You're minimising your own emotion. Right?
You
go to
become empowered with understanding where they were at, perhaps.
You will only understand after you've dealt with your emotion, not before. See, what we do is we intellectually skip over everything, skip over all the emotion, and we say, no, I really want to understand my parents. They were nice parents and they were loving. They did their best for me and all that stuff, right? And all of that might be true. But what you've just done is avoided all of your own painful emotions. Because you're now saying, because they were nice and they did their best, I'm not allowed to feel what I feel. And what you're going to need to learn to do is, I'm allowed to feel what I feel. I'm allowed to know what I know. I'm allowed to think what I think. I'm allowed to... These are what you will need to be allowed to do if you're going to feel your emotions. So one of the biggest blocks you have right now is all of this justification that you have about your parents and how they treated you. That's a huge block. Yeah? Big block.
Moshe, are you saying there, for your own healing, to face that, but not to, that doesn't mean to blame?
As soon as you blame, you're now projecting.
Yeah.
So I can state the truth. My mother never hugged me my entire life.
And feel it.
And feel what that felt like.
Without blame.
Without blaming my mother. She had her own reasons to do that. Right? But if I want to blame my mother, I'm allowed to do that too, if I want. But you're never going to get to the bottom of the underlying emotion. But you can blame her for 6 months if that's what you feel like doing first. You're allowed to do that too. But it'd be better if you can connect to the underlying emotion, was that feeling of, like, what does it mean if your mother's never hugged you? What does it mean?
So that's a more ideal way.
Yeah. So let yourself feel that. Now, my mother was 16 when she gave birth to me, like, and her mother was 16. So do you think they had many mothering skills? Like, my grandmother was 32 when I was born. So do you think they've had many mothering skills to pass down to each other? Obviously not, hey. And then my grandmother lived in this abusive, violent, alcoholic man who constantly abused her and beat her up and everything. You know, so of course my mother doesn't know what love is, really. But that's immaterial.
By you understanding that about your mother and your grandmother, does that empower you to work through your process?
No.
No, or is it irrelevant?
Often it's the opposite. It shuts down the process. Because what it does is I'm justifying them all the time, and what am I doing when I'm doing that?
Not knowing your own.
Denying. I'm not allowed to feel what I feel because they're nice.
Yeah.
And my mum is nice. But there's some terrible emotions that I've had to deal with because of her treatment of me. And there's some terrible emotions you've had to deal with even when your mum and dad were nice. Because they denied those emotions. that you now have to deal with, how they treated you. And if you're constantly justifying them, you're not going to look at yourself. You need to state the truth about everything. And this gets down to a really big issue, actually.
I'm fiercely annoyed.
Well, we found the core of emotion. It's just whether you want to feel it, isn't it?
I probably still don't know how to actually feel it, though. Does it mean talking about it or something?
Or no. Obviously, talking about it can help you. Yeah. But feeling an emotion and talking about it are two totally different things. You know, this is what unfortunately, what a lot of group type therapies do. We talk about the emotion, but very few people in the talking about it really connect with it, the emotion. Right?
There are a lot of people in life who want everything to be absolutely perfect. They do their absolute best. Everything has to be crossed and dotted. And the world's just not like that. Life's just not like that. And there is actually a religion out there that they, I was told, when they're making handmade carpets that are beautifully, beautifully handcrafted, and if it's really perfect, they actually put a mistake in there, just because nothing is to be 100% perfect.
Yeah.
Yeah. So they will actually make a mistake in all their carpets.
Yeah. So what was the reason for that comment?
Well, it's accepting that everything is not perfect.
Yep.
And don't expect it.
Yep, but see, aren't you intellectualising the whole thing again?
Yeah. But then we get annoyed, which is an emotion, when it's not perfect.
Yeah, but see, if I'm annoyed when it's not perfect, there's an emotion I need to feel. If I just go down the track, if I need to...
You've got to deal with it, don't you? So you've got to deal with that emotion, which might be your upbringing that everything has to be perfect, but it doesn't.
Yeah, but the thing is, I have a feeling inside of me that it does. Mm. So what do I do with that?
Can't you? You say you can't intellectually deal with it.
You won't be able to. Remember, everything is in me. Everything's in the soul.
Not in the head.
Not in my head. So I'm going to have to feel like I need to be perfect, and I'm going to have to feel where that began.
Well, I think we have probably accepted that it was probably from childhood.
But we've only accepted when we've experienced the emotion. And if I haven't experienced the emotion, then I haven't accepted. I can tell myself all I like that I've accepted. But if I haven't experienced the emotion, I have yet to accept. You see, this is the problem with our intellect.
Mm.
Right? We can tell ourselves all these things, right? And come to believe half of them as well. Mm. When inside of our soul, we still haven't dealt with them. Right?
How can you deal with something that's on a daily basis from the time you're born?
By feeling the emotion.
Because you're saying to go back and feel every day of your life as a child.
If that's what's required, you are going to need to do that, yes.
And you don't discover it until you're 60.
Yes, I agree. Can you see how much you want to avoid your emotion? Because there's a very strong emotional projection coming from you right now. I want to avoid that process. There must be an easier way. And I'm saying to you, no, there's not an easier way. You are going to need to feel all those emotions. And you don't want that to be true, and that's okay. You're allowed to not have that true if that's what you want. But what I'm saying is it's the only way to atonement with God. Does that make sense?
Yes.
When you were exploring your sadness over the last moments, You said that you have some more to experience and that you haven't got to the bottom at all, there's more to it. So using the example of the lady who talked about her annoyance, and if she actually gets to the bottom of that, then she might get her passport the next day.
Yep.
How does someone know then that they've actually dealt with that, or that there's more connected to it?
Trust.
Yeah. Okay.
But same way.
To the same deep emotion, or it could be just another one attached to it.
Well, it doesn't really matter. If you're feeling all of your emotions, you're going to feel what is coming up the next time, the next time, the next time, the next time. You're not going to be selective. Look at what a child does. In the first century, it said very clearly, unless you become like a little child, you cannot enter the kingdom of heaven. What does a child do?
Experiences
everything there and then. Don't they?
Unless they get stopped.
Unless they get shut down. Yeah. And this is how you will become. you will experience everything as soon as it occurs. Do you want to do that?
Yes.
Lots of you don't want to do that. Well, lots of you believe that at this moment, that that's dangerous. That's, I'm afraid of that. What's going to happen? What's that going to look like? What? How much of a mess is my life going to be if I do that? Right? And these are all of the fears that you have that are coming up, saying, oh, no, I can't do that. Like, some of you even feel a sense of panic. What is he telling me?
So these feelings of panic, of blocking, really what is blocked is the mind, yes? The mind is blocking.
The mind through... Well, what's actually coming up is there's an emotion coming up that I don't want to feel. And if one of the emotions coming up is, I don't want to feel, then the mind's going to say, oh, okay, I'll help you not feel.
It seems to be like the person picture or scenario of the majority of people who live, say, in Nordic countries like Scandinavia, Britain, you know, America. The people, say, who live in Eastern Europe, not the majority, not everyone, but let's say Cuba or Brazil, they seem to be somehow suffering or experiencing the exact opposite. Like, emotions are bubbling up all the time, and there's like maybe even more chaos in their lives than there is in the person who seems to block the emotion before it gets too scary. So would you say that in the end what you need is to be aware of your emotions, of what is actually happening, because otherwise you will end up with chaos?
The only time you end up with chaos is if you don't allow yourself to feel the causal emotion to completion.
Projection.
That's when you end up with chaos. Because chaos is the projection of emotion onto everyone and everything around you. That only happens when you avoid. I do agree that many of the countries you mentioned, like Cuba and South America and so forth, are more passionate. They allow more passion. And that it actually makes it easier for them to access underlying emotion. However, where it goes wrong is when they don't allow themselves to actually take full responsibility for those emotions and they blame others for them.
So they're being tossed around by false emotions mainly without being able to go to the core because they're not aware.
Yeah, so let's say one of them feels annoyed. He'll come up you right into your face and he will tell you right there and then, I'm annoyed with you, right? Now, a man in Britain says he's annoyed, and what does he do?
Drink.
You know, he sits down and just... like, I spent a bit of time in the subway last trip there, it was quite interesting. Have you ever been on the subway in England? Like in London? Yeah, isn't that an interesting experience? Yeah. I was quite amazed by it, actually.
So just sorry, just to find you. So would you say that being conscious of these core emotions, and that process is also important, that you can't just sort of just feel, you also need to be aware of the feeling?
No, what I'm saying is you need to feel everything. You need to feel everything and love feeling everything. However, when they are capping-based emotions like anger, fear, doubt, and lots of other types of emotions like that, jealousy, neediness, and all those kind of capping emotions, you need to understand that all of those are covering over the real things.
So real feelings are aware by themselves?
The real feelings are there, and you're just avoiding them by being in this state. Right? So a man who's in South America screaming and yelling at you, he's passionate, which is great, but he's avoiding his underlying emotions still. The man who's sitting on the subway stewing in England, not feeling anything, right, is still avoiding them. He's shutting himself down with detunement, with numbness, but he's still avoiding the underlying emotions he feels. The key is to get to the underlying emotion, to experience that. When you experience that, all of those capping ones don't occur. None of them occur.
Are there any clues on how to do that?
Isn't that what I've been talking about? Because I thought that's what I was talking about.
If on my journey I attracted an occupation, which I'm a school teacher, and I'm suddenly coming to the realisation that, you know, I need to be heard, does that mean when I am beginning to, or I deal with the wholeness of the issue, that suddenly the occupation won't appeal to me anymore?
Do I need to be
open to that?
Yeah, you need to be open to that.
Go to work on Monday.
all of you need to be open to the fact that your entire life will change. Yeah. Are you open to that?
Yes. Right.
Yeah. It's easy to say, but I tell you what. Are you open to actually having a different partner than you've got right now? Yes. Are you open to that? Are you open to having your children not wanting to see you ever again? Are you open to that? Can you see what you might need to be open to?
Everything.
Everything. Every possible thing you need to be open to. Because we're talking about your emotions. You need to be open to them. And that's going to create, that's going to need courage, isn't it?
I confuse myself a bit, but I have always had a thing with not really speaking up when my beliefs are crossed, and I sort of tend to look at things from multiple angles and get myself confused, but I don't know whether that's, like, is speaking up, feeling the emotion, or blaming and not owning the emotion, or is not speaking up, not feeling, a feeling of not worthy to speak. Like, I don't, like, which one is it?
What's the feeling inside? What do you feel it is?
I don't know, I just don't want to speak up.
You don't want to speak up?
Yeah.
What's the fear you have associated with speaking up? What do you think is going to happen?
Probably a loss of love, I suppose.
A loss of love? In other words, what? People are going to disapprove of you?
Yeah.
Right? So what do you not want to feel? People's disapproval. So yeah, in that case it would be an avoidance of an emotion. Not speaking up would be an avoidance. You can actually then do the opposite. You can speak up and let that emotion come up.
But then if I'm speaking up, am I then not owning my emotion and blaming it on them?
No. It depends how you look at it. See, everything's based on your intention. What's your intention? If your intention is to speak up to trigger the emotion that's underneath the reason why you don't want to speak, then that's an intention that's going to be helpful to you, right? But if your intention is to speak up because you want to yell at somebody and blame them, then obviously that intention is not going to be helpful to you.
But if I attracted it in the first place, wouldn't it, don't I sort of need to own it a little bit? Or?
You always need to own it. Yeah, always own it. Yeah, set your intention to always look at yourself. So in this case, the feeling that you had before speaking up was, you know, I'm not going to be liked, or somebody's not, you know, not going to love me if I speak up. So what are you avoiding? The feeling of being unloved. Right? So go deeper into that feeling of being unloved. Let yourself connect with that feeling. So, you know, sometimes what you'll need to do is just imagine a scenario. Like that scenario before about the passport. You just imagine now that it's the day you're going to travel and there's no passport. Hey, let yourself go into those emotions. Let yourself feel that anger you feel, and then let yourself feel what's underneath that, and just go into those emotions. You can do that. You can allow yourself to go into that place. And it'll bring up lots of things if you do it. If you allow it.
So you picture the worst-case scenario and deal with it perhaps before it comes.
You can do that, yeah. I've done that plenty of times in my own progression, where I've, you know, like, how can I get up in front of 100 people and say that I'm Jesus? How do you reckon that happened? Don't you think I had some fears about that? Oh, yeah, sure. I'm sure that would bring up something for me too.
Yeah.
So how did you get over it? Did you just feel the emotions around that fear?
Yeah, I just placed myself in a place where, you know, I just imagined 1,000 people yelling and screaming at me because I'm saying I'm Jesus. And what was all the stuff coming up? Like, and it took 4 months. every day to deal with that one emotion. So, you know, so I had to come to terms with a lot of things that somebody might want to kill me. And there has been, I have had a lot of death threats as a result. So I've had to work my way through all of those emotions.
When I saw the DVD the other day, I remember thinking, how could he be saying he's Jesus, you know?
Yeah. And I get that almost in every single time I get up to speak, I get that reaction generally.
Well, because the content was so interesting, that's why even now this minute I think it's probably
cool. He's insane, but he's making a lot of sense. Yeah, no, I'm just joking with you. But that emotion alone took a long time for me to work through it. And I did have to work through so many things about that. You know, where were all of these memories that I've got coming from? What was that, you know, why were they here? You know, how did all this happen? All of those different things I had to work through emotionally. Like, and so, you know, it's the same with yourself. There'll be lots of things that happen in your life as a result of you dealing with your emotions. Lots of things.
Yes, you talked about grief being a core emotion. Would emotions like guilt and shame be core rather than surface?
It depends. A lot of times guilt and shame come from other people. So a lot of times there are actually surface type emotions covering over deeper issues. But John Bradshaw has a theory about toxic shame, what he calls toxic shame. And toxic shame, in the end, isn't probably an emotion in itself, but he talks about the feeling that you're to blame for your own pain and for, you know, for what happened to you when you were little, as a child. And he calls that toxic shame, where you've become so ashamed of yourself because you created all of these terrible things that happened to you when you were a child. And a lot of abuse victims feel that.
So it's like a deep unworthiness.
A deep feeling of unworthiness, a deep feeling of being totally unlovable and I'm to blame.
Yes.
And that is what has been one of my core emotions, the feeling that I've been to blame for not being loved. That somehow there's something wrong with me that has created that, whatever that is. That I've, you know, and when you reincarnate coming from the 22nd sphere, in the 22nd sphere you are constantly receiving divine love. When you incarnate into your mother's womb, you receive divine love dependent upon whether your mother's receiving it. So if you can imagine receiving divine love constantly for nearly 2,000 years, and then all of a sudden coming into a situation where I can no longer feel my father's love, God's love, and I can no longer feel my soulmate's love anymore for 9 months. And that is one of my core emotions to deal with. Because I then went through my mother's filters, went through down this track of blaming. It must be something I did. And I'm still working through that issue. I still feel it's something that I did. Okay. So it's a very core issue. And you'll find feelings like that will be very core issues within you. Like a lot of people who are promiscuous, for example, have a core issue of feeling like they're nothing. They actually feel like they are nothing. And they've just got a body and whatever, but they're actually nothing. There's actually everything inside of them is dead. It just does not exist. And so they're constantly trying to get a feeling, and in this case a sexual feeling, in order to feel like there's something. So a lot of those kind of emotions are very deep causal emotions. Yeah.
Can you think of any others that might be causal or...
Feeling of nothing, feeling like I don't, like nobody wants me, nobody cares, all of those kind of, I'm unlovable and it's my fault, you know, all of those kind of things, I'm undesired and it's my fault, and all of those kind of things are all very deep core emotions that we get to.
So, AJ, if we've got those emotions, like that's really cool, you know, I'm unlovable, it's my fault. Is that a sign that we're not very developed as souls? Or, you know, in that new agey terms, they talk about old souls and new souls, and it's not so good to be a new soul because you're way down the track. Is that how it is? Or?
No, see, that's a judgment.
Yeah.
The truth is that all of these emotions came from, remember I said, here's your mum and dad, let's say, you know, here's you, little tiny baby. And what's happening is this soul, which envelops this child, is absorbing every projection from its environment. Now then, can we go and say that child is undeveloped?
No.
Can we blame the child for feeling all of these feelings?
So why would we choose to have parents when, you know, that are very, very dysfunctional?
Well, in the first DVD, if you could watch that, I actually say that we didn't choose our parents.
Mm-hmm. What about genetic diseases that you're actually born with?
Genetic diseases are caused again by the emotions passed down through, you know, subsequent parents.
So they can be healed too?
Totally, yeah. All disease can be healed. When you're at one with God, you'll never have another disease again. Mm-hmm. Ever. You won't be sick ever.
You know how you said in the first century that Mary was unfaithful to you, mm-hmm. right? Did she deal with that emotion at that time, or did it carry through to now?
No, she dealt with that emotion at that time, but the memory of that event certainly has had an impact on her now.
Yeah.
Because yep. She is now through some more filters of the parents she has this time, which has caused new emotions for her to deal with. So she has a deep feeling of shame about anything to do with, you know, cheating on somebody or anything like that. She can't even watch the movie that involves it. Right, she struggles to watch a movie involving it because she has a deep...
So she's just blocking them out, isn't she? She's not dealing with it?
Well, I can't say what she's dealing with and not dealing with because I haven't seen her for the last 3 weeks or so. I can't really say what she's...
wounded.
Yeah, well, you know, 3 weeks ago. Everything changes really rapidly on the path, right? And Mary is on the path now. So, you know, she is dealing with her emotions as best she can at the moment. And I'd probably like to not comment too much about her processing because at some point in time she will want to comment about them. And of course, because I haven't spoken to her for some time, it's difficult for me to know the exact emotions that she's going through aside from what I can feel. But the thing is that she certainly has some deep shame issues about those events in the first century. And she has been quite upset about them over the last four to 6 months. And she sort of feels like, there's also some anger there too, where she feels like I get to be the nice one and she gets to be the... So there's some issues there too. That she, of course, it's totally the opposite of that. In reality, I've had a lot more emotions to deal with this time round than she has to deal with. But, yeah, but she had lots to deal with in the first century.
I haven't watched the DVD, I have heard of it. So does she now know that she is your...
She knows that I feel she is.
There's an issue.
Because I've heard that she didn't know, so I was just checking.
Yeah, on the DVD, when that occurred, I'd met her only sort of 3 or 4 weeks earlier, and she didn't know that I felt she was my soulmate. But what actually happened is, in a very, very roundabout way, her parents found out that I felt that she was my soulmate, and they told her. And I was sort of going to wait for quite some time until I felt she was ready to be told. But her parents told her. And she emailed me while I was overseas. The two-line email. On February the 14th.
Thank you, see you later.
No, it was... I heard... I loved it, actually. I thought it was great. She said, I heard that you think that we have some kind of soul connection. I would like to investigate this further. But I would like to know what you feel about this. And that was it.
Cool.
And so I emailed her back, and then she emailed me, and then I emailed her back, and so forth. And then about a month later, she came overseas and caught up, and we met up in London. So we spent a couple of months together before we got home. But we decided when we got home to be apart so that we could deal with a lot of the emotions that were coming up. Mm.
Yeah. Did it feel like old times?
I mean it. me it did, yeah. But for her, it felt very confusing because she sort of expected to come to England to prove me wrong, and to up to then she hadn't had any memories from the first century, and she felt that she was attracted to me, but she couldn't understand why, but she felt that she wanted to resolve it one way or the other. And within 3 or 4 days she started having memories about some first century events. A lot of it was anger with me, actually, for leaving her and for dying and things like choosing to die and things like that. She knew that I'd made that choice. And when I say I'm choosing to die, it's not like suicide or anything. I chose to follow a path that would result in my dying, and I knew that it probably would.
So you didn't move to France and have children together and all that?
We certainly had one child. Yeah, she was pregnant when I died, and Sarah is our child. And she did move to France after my passing. And Sarah met up with Luke, her soulmate, there in France. But, yeah, there were a lot of traumatic events that happened after my death for her, for me. And she started feeling all of those first, of course, which meant she started feeling lots of anger and rage towards me first. And then she started having quite a number of different memories. And she got to a point where of saturation where she just couldn't cope with any more. And she started detuning after that emotionally. So at the moment, she's sort of trying to work through how come she had those feelings.
Thank you.
And how come she had those memories. And she's trying to work out what's actually happening inside of herself, you know, whether it's a spiritual attachment that's feeding her those memories, or whether it's a feeling inside of her, or whatever. And I've had to work through all of those feelings too, of course. So I understand where she's at, but I just miss her.
Why did you choose such a traumatic situation to come into? Was it just to sort of re-earth yourself again, or because you would have had a choice this time, I would think.
Total choice, yeah. We even had the choice just to materialise, which would have meant not experiencing birth again or anything like that, or experiencing the soaking of this, you know, the childhood's soul, soaking up parents' emotions and so forth. But my feelings and the feelings of the 14 were that if we did that, then we'd lose touch with everyone we were trying to assist.
So what do you say? You had the choice to not go through birth, but to just...
When you're in the 22nd sphere state, you can materialise any body you want at any time. So at the moment there's thousands of spirits or souls, complete souls in that state, and they could, if they wanted to, just materialise a form right now and stand in front of you. The problem with that, of course, the problems associated with that are numerous, because what would you then think? You would then think they're special, they're equal to you, you know, and you'd go down the track. And what are we trying? Like, my greatest goal is to teach you that I'm the same as you.
It'd be hard to get a passport, wouldn't it?
Yeah. Not that you'd need one. But see, one of the greatest things to understand is that none of the 14 who have returned have a feeling that they're better than you. You're the same as us. We're the same. We're just people. Right? You have the same potentialities of what we've experienced. And by our experience, we are showing, you know, I'm going through all of these different emotions that I'm going through to show you that it works, right? And that, and I don't lose hold of that as one of my goals. Right? It's one of my goals is to show people that this is the way to, you can be at one with God on earth. You don't have to wait to the spirit world, you know, you don't have to wait till you die.
Being at one with God, do you actually communicate and can talk and hear him or not?
You can hear him, but not in the sense that you're probably thinking.
No.
It's you hear in the sense of there's this, the feelings enter you from God directly, and then words appear within you associated with those feelings. And in fact, that's how you communicate with every soul in the seventh, eighth sphere and above. So the forms of communication used there are totally different from the forms of communication we use. Yeah. They're all based on this emotion to emotion transaction And because my emotions are pure and your emotions are pure, it means that I can feel your emotions and accurately know what they are. It's only when my emotions have filters that I'm feeling your emotions and think they're something different. So everything that happens on the eighth sphere and above is all emotion into emotional transaction.
You discuss it as you, at one, you learn God's truth more and more and you come to know greater knowledge. Mm-hmm. But is that still interpreting the feeling versus a verbal discussion where you were hearing words and listening and absorbing that knowledge? So how do you actually gain that knowledge directly from God if it's just a feeling, or is it you're interpreting of that feeling to become knowledge?
Yeah, in the Paget messages, the Apostle John wrote a section of on truth and how it's discovered. And in that section, it's worth reading. He explained how I determined truth in my life and what I actually did to find out truth. And it's a very accurate reflection of what I did. But it's about feeling the feelings that you get from God and then putting them into practice to see whether they work. And obviously, if they don't work, then you've got your interpretation of the feeling has been incorrect. Right? If they do work, then obviously you've now added another truth to your soul that you can then build on for the next truth that it comes to you. And that's why above the eighth sphere, even though you're at one with God, there's still like this huge area where you're learning more and more and more and more truth before you can actually be at one with your soulmate, right, which is in the 22nd sphere, because there is so much truth to actually learn even after you've become at one with God. And truth is something that will be infinite, so therefore truth is never, you're never going to be able to say you know the truth like God knows the truth. All we can do is approach that. Yeah.
Do you personally feel the emotions of somebody you're directly communicating with?
Yeah, I feel the emotions of... at the moment I feel... I suppose it's going to be hard to believe, but I can feel the emotions of whole groups of people on the earth here in the room, all of your different emotions that you're projecting at me. At times, if I allow myself, I can feel what they are. And so you come to appreciate after a while that every single interaction with each other is emotional, actually. Right? And I can feel all of your emotions. Those of you who are doubting, I can feel your doubts. And those of you who are afraid about dealing with your emotions, I can feel that. And those of you who want to deal with your emotions but feel that it's going to be too much for you, I can feel that. And so you could basically say that there's this wall of emotion coming from you. And if there's anything resonant inside of myself, in other words, if there's anything I've yet to deal with inside of myself, and there is, those emotions will resonate with me in certain ways. When you're at one with God, they no longer resonate with you. So you feel them and they pass straight through you without you actually feeling any pain from them. No matter what the painful emotion is being projected. But at the moment, that's not where I'm at. At the moment, I've got every time I've stood up so far, like since I've been back home, I've still got my biggest thing is the unworthiness at the moment. And so every time I get up to speak, I get this back pain, lower back pain, that's second chakra, all to do with unworthiness. And so, you know, that's what I'm feeling. And when you feel your doubts, it's not when you express the words, but when you feel your doubts about what I'm saying, I can feel that. And after a while, you'll be more and more sensitive and you'll be able to feel it from everyone around you. So you've got to be brave in a lot of ways, because sometimes a lot of the emotions that you're going to feel are going to be quite negative in terms of your experience, but they're only negative because they resonate with something inside of you.
There's obviously nothing wrong with having all those different emotions, and some of these emotions we have to have on a daily basis, and we can't do anything about it.
Sure.
We are sort of employed, getting paid, we have deadlines, all sorts of issues in life.
Yeah, but see, those three that you mentioned, I would call them all false beliefs.
Well, you've given commands and demands.
From who?
And I'm saying if you're employed and you need the income, you've got...
yeah, but see, all of those are false beliefs. And this is, I'm going to challenge you a lot if you keep listening to me. The truth is that you think you need an income. And that has become your reality. The truth is that's not how God made you. The truth is...
How could we have got here today if we didn't have...
Yeah, but see, now you're going very intellectual. Let me finish what I'm saying. The truth is that God didn't make you that way. God made you to be this perfect attracting machine that attracts everything it needs automatically without you needing to do anything. Aside from feel everything. To feel your passion, feel your desire, follow that.
Still have to survive,
it
doesn't matter.
See, now that's your mind. This is your mind. I'm telling you, this is your mind kicking into gear. This is your mind kicking into gear. You believe the unreality you've created. You believe the dream. Honestly, all of you here at some state, including myself, believe the dream. But it's not real. God never created you this way. God created you to be this perfect person who needs nothing outside of itself. That's how God created you. We have created all these things we think we need. Do you follow me?
Yeah? God created us to populate the world. We populate the world. There's not enough food there, so we've got to create it.
Of course, but what's that got to do with money and working and everything? It's got nothing to do with money and working and everything. We created that too. Because we wanted to place a value on this and a value on that. And we wanted to then compare. And we wanted to make myself better than you. And that I wanted to have more wealth than you. And I wanted to create... And these are all these different creations that are all based on these emotions that I got right from the time I was an infant, right the way through. And now I believe them to be true. I believe them to be real. But they're not. From God's perspective. Remember I said to you, do you want your truth or do you want God's truth? Right? What do you want?
As you were saying that Jesus said, or you said, that it was easier for a mustard seed to enter heaven in the kingdom of God than for a man, because mustard seed, well, it doesn't have faith and truth, where a man just can't comprehend that.
Yeah. See, a lot of times what we've done is we've lost the very basics that God has given us. And we've constructed this whole dream-like state that we now believe is true. We believe it's real, but it's not real. And the proof is it really, like, it causes all this destruction. This whole system that you and me want to stay believing in causes all these terrible, terrible things in the world. Why do you think a third of the world is starving to death? Because we believe what we believe, right here. That's why a third of the world is starving to death. And we need to change our beliefs, and the only way we're going to do that is to feel our emotions. Yeah.
So if one person was to get complete faith, would everyone else's negativity bring them down if that's sort of all connected?
No, but see, once you're at one with God, now, how can anyone draw you down?
Well, keep it real, sort of like as a, I don't know.
But see, once you're at one with God, you're getting supplied with God's love constantly. Yeah. How can anybody draw you down? They can't. So that's how you become the light of the world.
But you know how you said, if you're negative, it affects other people.
It's not if you're negative that affects other people. It's when you choose to not experience your emotion that it affects other people.
But like the animal equation, how we eat them... can everyone else affect you, is what I mean. Even if you got complete faith, can all the other people around affect you, like we affect the animals? Or...
No, they can't. That's the beauty of doing... See, the animals don't have a soul, and they can't have a connection with God in the direct sense that a human soul can. Right? When we have a direct connection with God, once we're at one with God, nothing can affect us. And how can anything affect God? If we're at one with God, how can anything affect us? That makes sense, right?
Yeah.
So the key is become at one with God, then none of these things will affect you. You won't even believe them. You won't even believe you need money anymore. You won't believe it anymore. And everyone around you will believe what they think is the truth. And they'll argue with you and try to fight with you about it. But the truth is that you know it's not real. You'll know.
And so is that then, therefore, the so-called reality changes because everyone's lenses are seen through love and the animals
yeah.
be taken care of.
Yeah.
The earth would heal itself.
Exactly. Everything would heal. Everything would heal if all of us took responsibility for our emotion, connected with God to the point of abundance. Absolutely everything that is currently negative in our environment would just automatically disappear.
The reverse would be true, what he said, really, because you would affect everybody around you.
Exactly. Exactly. That's why one person in the first century at one with God caused lots of changes on the earth. Like, you imagine 100 of you being at one with God? You imagine what that would do? Like, the whole world would change just from totally. Just from 100 people being at one with God.
Change. That's all anger over there. That's millions of people.
Everything will change. Right? But see, even a lot of your judgments now, you believe at the moment that a lot of the anger is over there, but it all was created in you. And this is where we need to take a lot of personal responsibility for what's going on in the world in general, by taking responsibility for our emotion.
So there must be a difference in feeling or emotion. Say, for example, if I step up to a fence and the dog feels aggressive and angry because I'm invading his or her territory. And then I step away from the fence and the dog relaxes. Now, that's what I feel like when I feel an emotion, say, of anger during an argument when somebody steps into the territory of my ego and I react.
Yep.
But I seem to be reacting like the dog.
Yep.
Only when I become conscious of my feeling of anger can I then really work with it.
Certainly, like, obviously, the mind, remember I said the mind is the dumb servant of the soul. So use your mind to help your soul. In other words, your soul be the driver, your emotions, your passions, your desires be the driver, and use your mind to do the things that it needs to do, like observe. Oh, I was just angry. That's the mind observing. Right? And allow then the connection with what's underneath that anger. You can certainly use your mind to do that. Then it's a tool. But if you use your mind to be dominant and suppress the soul and control the soul, manipulate the soul and keep it under control, then obviously in the end you're not going to be in a state of bliss in that state. You see, it's like, this is what we often do with our emotions. You know, The choice to be self-reliant has created everything.
As opposed to God-reliant.
As opposed to God-reliant. That's the original thing. You could call that, if you want to use a biblical term, why is because when you become self-reliant, you now need to decide in yourself what is harmonious with love and disharmonious with love and so forth. And of course, you're not going to be connected to God. Connection with God is about being God-reliant and understand, receiving things from God, receiving truth from God. Self-reliance is about, I want to hold on to my own truth. And many of you here today feel like that, if you're honest with yourself. You want to hold on to your own truth. You don't like what you're hearing. Right? A lot of you don't like what you're hearing, right? You want to hold on to your own truth. You're allowed to. You don't have to listen to this insane man, right? You're allowed to hold on to your own truth. But I'm saying to you, that is the original sin, if you like. That is the original cause of all this disharmony that we have on the earth today, was caused by every single person wanting to hold on to their own truth. Right? Let's just change it for a moment. Let's just imagine a world where every single person wants God's truth. How different is that world going to be? It's going to be totally different, isn't it? Totally different. Because now we're not self-reliant, we're God-reliant. So what's going to happen? As we're God-reliant, we're getting closer to God and closer to God. What else happens? We get closer to each other, don't we? Isn't that what happens too? Right? So what's caused all this separation is because each one of us wants to be self-reliant. I want to determine my truth, thank you. I want to determine what happens in my life, thank you. I want to control what's going on in my world.
So as all these species were developed on the earth, it was like survival instincts with the animals.
Can you feel what's going on inside of your soul at the moment?
Intellectuals sort of trying to work out.
There is this feeling of confusion. Can you feel that? Why are you asking all of these intellectual questions? Let yourself feel that. Why? What do you
I'm
want?
I'm thinking back to God and nothing on earth. And so he had, trying to realise God has no emotions, no anger, no...
I never said that. What did I say?
So I'm picturing all things bright and beautiful, all creatures, great and small, just everything absolutely harmoniously blissful on earth. Until that survival instinct came and they all started eating each other.
No. Until man came and started eating them. That's what happened. Like, what I'm saying is God is totally emotional. Totally an emotional being. God is not, definitely not, detuned from emotion. What do you think love is? Isn't it an emotion?
Yes, no, yes, I'm not talking about the beautiful emotions, I'm talking about the negative emotions.
No, God doesn't have any negative emotions, what you would classify as negative emotions. God doesn't feel rage or anger. Why would she? Everything she creates is perfect. Would you be angry if everything was perfect?
That's why I was picturing that. You asked me a question and I was actually picturing to the beginning, the creation.
Yep. Everything
and
was
everything
perfect.
Was bright and beautiful, creatures.
And this is what created everything different.
And there was no negativity until the survival instinct.
No, it's not the survival instinct. It was this. It was this.
Well, that's what I'm saying. Self-reliance is almost like survival.
No, they're not the same thing. What's survival instinct? There is, like, I'm saying everything is based around self-reliance, that things have gone bad, everything. It's based around me wanting to hold on to my truth, you wanting to hold on to yours, so Eudlo wanting to hold on to his, and we're all willing to disagree and argue and even fight and even go to war for it. Right? That's what's caused what we've got now. Right? If we all became God-reliant, what would happen? I would have to give up my truth. You would have to give up your truth. And we would all eventually have God's truth. Does that mean we're all robots still?
No,
because we've all got different personalities, unique, and in amongst this beautiful, large universe God created, you have the ability to do anything you want, harmonious with love. And in fact, once you got rid of that as the biggest emotion, you will want to do everything harmonious with love. And you'll enjoy that.
I work in a secondary school, and there are many students who are coming with the attitude of what I want is important and I know my own mind. And I've seen kids come up and make demands because that's what they know to be right. So this is all coming from that self-reliance stuff.
Yeah, and be careful. A person who is at one with God knows exactly what they want. But what they want is harmonious with love. Mm. The problem with many of these students that are coming up to you is they want things. But it's not harmonious with love. It's because of all this emotional damage added to it that they come up and they say, I want to do this and blow the rest or whatever. Right? But the truth is that if it's harmonious with love, if they're allowed, to want what they want, you're allowed to want what you want. You are.
But they're being taught to be assertive and stand up for their own rights. So that's where...
To see a person at one with God, and again I'm going to refer back to that all the time, is you won't feel like you need to stand up for your rights. No worries. Bye bye. Anybody can leave, by the way. It's getting pretty late, actually.
What's your opinion on 2012 and the golden age? And...
Can I answer that tomorrow, maybe? Yeah. Well, it's 6:15, guys. Yeah.
I think that the mention of self-reliance would be really interesting. Many people have come to be self-reliant because it's become a way of thinking. That's normal, and so they're not in touch with their feelings. Then if you come to actually accept that has been a lot of cause for lots of terrible things happening and ways of being, then you would have to go through a lot of very hard emotions around guilt and shame, maybe, I don't know, but just different emotions to say, wow, this has happened through self-reliance. I haven't been connected to God, so therefore... abandonment of that, and a grief, and many, so it would be very hard to let go of that too.
This is the hardest emotion to let go of in the end. The reason why it was because it was the very first multi-generational emotion. The people you know of as Adam and Eve, who were, the real name is Ammon and Aman, they chose self-reliance over God-reliance. It was the very first bit of emotional damage that got passed on to the next generation, this emotion. And so it's very deep within your core. Very deep within your core is this desire to want to control everything around you to your own pleasure. That's very deep within your core. And it will be an emotion that comes up for you a lot of times in your progression.
The question I have is, you said that when a child is born, they take on the emotions of their mother and father, but are they also taking on the emotions of their grandmother and grandfather, and their great and great and great? So we all have all the emotions of Adam and Eve.
Yep.
Thank you.
Yep.
So therefore we would actually have the memory to a certain extent?
Yeah, a lot of the emotions that hit you when you were a child were in the womb. Obviously, you don't have memories of the events associated with those emotions. And this is why your mind is very, really useless when it comes to dealing with emotion. Because many of the emotions you're going to need to allow yourself to feel, you won't actually have a memory of. You'll just have an emotion of. Because those emotions have been impressed down the generations to you.
So if you do have an emotion and you sit with it and embrace it and you get a vision or a knowing...
Yep. That'll be very likely a spirit friend of yours helping you understand where that emotion has come from, giving you a picture, if you like.
So with that vision and that spirit helping you get through that emotion, could we then have that belief that that's a parcel? But really, it's an emotion associated going all the way back to Adam and Eve.
That's how most people believe past lives, is that in reality it's just spirits that are with them, giving them different pictures to help them deal with their own emotions. But then they misinterpret those pictures into being a past life experience.
Thinking it's a past life.
Yep.
Okay. Just
answer. Is that actually a little excited now?
Sorry?
Was that then the ancestor's life?
Yeah. Yeah, that's right. It might not even be an ancestor. It might be like
someone else,
Joan of Arc, or someone who's famous. Even it could be coming to you. There's a lot of very famous people who are struggling in the spirit world to deal with their emotions, and there's a lot of spirits who are willing to put pictures into your mind, so that you think they're someone famous, so that you can have a rapport with them.
So when you deal with these emotions, they do. Clarify, you move them on, would you possibly be in a situation where you become
emotionless? No, never. In fact, what happens is you become like emotion full, I suppose. in that everything you do is driven by desire and passion. Everything. So you become more joyous, more open, more free with all of your emotions. Yeah. So it's the opposite to detachment.
So it's basically divine love.
Well, it's not. You're allowed to have... Of course, even though you've connected with God and are one with God, you're still your own person. So you will still have your own desires, your own passions, your own longings, your own areas that you want to investigate. And you'll have like... And the more and more you live in your free will, the more powerful you become as a soul, the more you can actually obtain and actually enjoy. So your joy actually abounds more and more and more, not less. You become more emotional, more desirous, more passionate. You have better love with your partner. And all those kind of things all happen as a part of the process. Did I just say the right thing to somebody?
Do you believe that God feels collective grief and aches for humanity and feels pain?
No. God does feel your emotion, but God does not experience your emotion. Do you know the difference, like what I'm saying? Like, so God knows what you're feeling, but God does not feel the pain along with you. And when you become at one with God, you will know exactly what your next door neighbour is feeling, but you will not have to feel their emotion with them. It's exactly the same principle.
That's great.
Right? So you will know everyone's emotion in this room, you will know. But you will not cry because she feels like crying, and you will feel your own emotion still. And that's how God is too with us.
AJ, is there another way besides crying? Because we haven't actually heard, I still don't know about the passport. Like perfection or imperfection, whichever. It's Jones.
Yeah.
Is experiencing either the need to be perfect or the imperfection. I'm still not clear on that.
The issue is more to do with how it felt being a child.
Yeah.
Like having to feel like she's got to be perfect all the time. And there will certainly be a lot of tears that she'll express about that issue.
But is there another way besides crying?
Do you want there to be another way? Do you want there to be another way?
Absolutely. Because if you're doing one kind of work, I have to agree with the lady.
Yeah.
It depends which work you're doing as well. It depends. So if you're doing a certain job, you couldn't be crying all the time.
Can you see what you're trying to do, though?
I knew you'd switch it back to that.
So why did you ask the question?
Because I'm going to carry on and ask you. Yeah. You said, would you like it to happen any other way? I mean, can't you do the breathing that no one can notice? Can't you do the thymus?
You can try to do all those things if you want. I'm not
saying it won't work.
No.
It's got to be. Yeah. It's got to be crying.
Well, let's look at the different emotions. When you feel like joy, what do you do?
Laugh.
Okay, you laugh, eh? Oh, you just don't breathe. Like, for what? Don't you? If you really feel mirthful, what do? You laugh your head off, don't you? You laugh till you cry, almost. Right? I'm saying, what do you do? Oh, see? What's this inappropriate thing?
Right, okay. All right. I'm a palliative care nurse, and that's what I've done for 8 years, and there are lots of times it's inappropriate to laugh, and it's actually, it's very appropriate to cry sometimes, but not about your emotions, because you're with the person, you're not with yourself.
Does God think this? Does God think your emotions are ever inappropriate?
Well, I'm not at one with God, so I don't know.
Well, what do you think? Yeah. Do you think God would ever feel that your emotions are inappropriate?
No.
Ever?
Well, to show, experience them. You know, you said you could feel them. Then you've got to experience them.
Well, experiencing them is feeling them. But God...
No, you said feeling, you could feel something, but you don't have to actually experience.
No, I said basically you can sense the emotion from somebody.
Yeah.
But experiencing it is... Like, you're actually experiencing it is really feeling it
in for yourself, right? So
yeah.
So you're saying you're feeling your emotions under certain circumstances is inappropriate. Is that what you're saying?
Experiencing them, yes, because
yeah.
Your needs are secondary.
No, I don't want to know the reason why you believe it, because it's wrong.
So you're saying just go around crying whenever you have to.
Sorry?
Just
yeah, that's what I'm saying.
Whenever, wherever, doesn't
yeah.
matter. Who else is going to be affected by it?
Yeah.
Can you fake it till you make it?
And if you don't like it, you can't express yourself there.
Are there any other parts? That's what I'm saying. I'm saying that your emotion is never inappropriate.
Well, I'll be crying all the time next week.
That's okay.
No, it's not okay.
It's not okay.
I'm not telling you.
But can you see the feeling you have? What's the feeling you have? It's not okay. You have this feeling, it's not okay. Why isn't it okay? It's a fear you have. And all you're doing at the moment is voicing your fear. What's the fear?
No, I didn't really want to
release. Are you backing out now on me?
Can't you breathe through it? Can't you do something else besides showing the world that you're crying tears?
Ah, now we're getting to the real issue.
But that's what I'm asking. Because I'm with families and dying people, and we're not talking any age group here. We're talking about people
yep.
that are dying
yes.
with their little ones coming to see them.
Yes.
Now, I can cry with them, anybody in you know this sort of work, you can cry with them
yeah.
and feel their pain,
yeah.
but you can't be crying for you. Because that has to wait. It's like a mother and her children. She'll put her husband and her children first, and she'll sort herself out.
And this is where it all begins. This is where it all begins, and it's all going to cause grief. Honestly, we need to experience our emotions 100% of the time. That's how God made you. You have a fear here. The fear is, you're going to get judged if you feel your emotions. You're going to have pain from others if you feel your emotions. You feel it's inappropriate. These are all childhood beliefs that entered you, that you were going to need to feel before you were going to be able to feel your emotions.
Well, I look to others, if we're talking that way, look to others' needs first.
And that is actually incorrect.
Yeah.
Do you think God wants you to look at others' needs first?
But we're not realised. We're not at one with God.
See, that's what I call that excuse.
God made us. We are told to look after ourselves first, and then look after our children.
See, we often use excuses in order to not feel. We use excuses to not feel.
So it also might be one of those times where you go through something and then you realise, gee, I'm not in the right job for me to be able to be my true self.
Yeah, and if you're not in the right job, then pray for a different job, and if it's a heart longing, you'll go there. But you might be in the right job for your soul to go through that emotion. See, a lot of times what we do is we avoid situations. And we pray to avoid situations, when in reality our souls created that situation exactly for the emotion that we need to trigger. Right? I was talking a few days ago with a lady who rang me from Western Australia. She has had, her husband left her 10 years ago, and he still rings her up and abuses her. And she takes it. And she gets off the phone, she yells and screams at him back. Right? And then gets off the phone really angry and upset. What's happening? She's attracting it, and she doesn't want to deal with the underlying emotion. That's why she yells and screams back. Right? And the truth is that the excuse that you're using is, I'm in a public setting, I can't feel my emotion. I've got to do it appropriately. That is an excuse, that is an emotion within you. God doesn't feel that way. And then you use another excuse saying, but I'm not God at one with God yet, so I'm allowed to get away with that. Well, you can get away with it for as long as you want. You've got free will. I agree. But do you want to? Don't you want to be at one with God? Mm. Or do you want to be, like, separate from God all the time?
Well, my original question was, is there any other way besides God?
And I answered it. I just said no.
jumping or breathing, somewhere.
All of those things detune you from your emotion. They do.
So it's not to be crying. I'm worried about my.
If you're sad. Yeah, but well, if it's sadness or grief, yes. If it's sadness or grief, cry. If you're happy, laugh. I know. See what you're wanting to do? Select it. Remember what I said humility was right at the start. What did I say? Feeling every emotion, whether it's painful or pleasurable. That's what I said humility was. Now, you can choose to not be humble if you want and only experience the pleasurable ones and no painful ones. But what's going to happen is more and more pain in your life.
No, I meant at work.
I don't care where you're meant.
At work, I'm talking specifically.
I know that's what you're talking about. I heard it many times. Trust me, I did. If you feel like laughing, you're allowed to laugh.
Oh, I'm so sorry, but that's just.
But that feeling
that person might
come to you.
Yeah,
that's
like
why
you feel like you laugh. Unless it would I laugh, like the laugh is knowing, you know, that this is all, you know. The dream. The Buddha laugh.
The Buddha laugh.
The person around the bedside, you're with, just as they're dying. Yep. They're not going to. That's unloving. That's unloving.
Isn't no. What's unloving is for you to suppress any of your own emotion. That's unloving towards you. Now, one thing all of you need to realise about love is love does not treat another person like you. Like differently to yourself. So I won't let you cry while I'm not allowing myself to cry. I won't shut down you, or I won't allow, like, I will always do things within myself that allows both of us to experience our emotions. Right? That's what love does. As soon as I shut down myself, I am no longer being loving to myself. And from God's perspective, you are just as important as the person next to you. So if you feel like laughing and the person next to you feels like crying, you're both allowed to do that. Right at the same moment, if you want.
And if it's loving, it's truth, then both will feel okay.
Exactly. You won't be projecting blame or anger or upset with each other. You won't be judging each other because you'll both be owning your own emotion.
So, if I'm having an argument with a loved one or parent, daughter, or whatnot, it escalates to the point where I'm feeling like screaming or hitting that person, would it be appropriate to tell that person that I need to step away to feel the deeper emotion or to process that? Is that using the mind or is that just...
If you're arguing, you need to step away then. Because if you're arguing, what are you doing?
Not feeling your emotion.
You're not feeling your emotion. You need to go away, feel your emotions. Right at that point. It won't ever escalate to yelling and screaming. If you, as soon as you not feel your emotion, you reckon, I'm not feeling my emotion. I'm not owning my stuff. I am now projecting a need onto them. I need to get away from this and retune back in and feel my stuff.
Isolation, it's okay to...
Yeah, and it's easy with your imagination just to put yourself back in the situation. What did they say to you that triggered all of your feelings of wanting to argue back? And let yourself go there emotionally. But do it. Own it. As soon as you get into an argument, you're not owning it anymore. You're wanting them to do something for you now, and you're not owning it yourself as soon as you're in an argument. But you're allowed to argue as much as you want, if that's what you want. So I'm not saying you're not allowed to argue. What I'm saying is that when you argue, observe. Use that mind you have as a tool to observe. I'm arguing. I must be avoiding something. What am I avoiding? And tune into that.
Can you just talk about, remember what happened in Dallas where that people didn't want to cry if it was going to look ugly? And you said if an emotion goes into you at an age of one, it's going to come out looking like one.
Exactly.
And I thought that was a really good thing for me.
Yeah.
It helped me a lot.
Yeah. Does everyone understand what that means?
Right.
If an emotion enters you at 1 year of age, and you didn't feel it when you were one, and you now are 40, and you're now connecting with that 1 year of age emotion, you're going to look like your 1 year old dealing with it.
Would you act like a 1 year old?
You're going to act like a 1 year old dealing with it.
That means on the floor.
I have a tantrum.
Yeah. Can you understand why?
Yeah.
What happens inside of you is every single emotion you have not allowed yourself to feel gets frozen in time. Right? Have I just made you more afraid?
Oh, no. Sorry. Yeah. I thought it would help.
Yeah, it's time to feel more afraid.
I do.
And it's 6 o'clock. And so somebody says,
I don't want to go
home. I have been going for 5 hours.
Yeah.
And I'm sure your bums must be hurting. And I think it's probably an appropriate time to stop.
Yeah.
And tomorrow we're back again at 1, and probably similar time frames if you want to stick around. We'll continue the discussion more about emotions and the law of attraction, I think. We need to spend a bit more time with that. What I would like you to do tonight, if you can, if you're coming tomorrow, have a think about the law of attraction in your own life. And what I would like to do is have a few people come up with me and sit down and explain something that happened, just an event this week or last week that happened, that triggered an emotion in you, and then we'll talk about what law of attraction was trying to expose.
Cool.
How's that sound? And so that way you get some practical feelings about how it actually works in a practical way in terms of helping you access the underlying emotion. And hopefully a few of you might even connect with the underlying emotion and not be embarrassed and cry. But that's okay. And we'll just, and if not you, then I will. There's a few I haven't dealt with this week. So.